And over to you, Tejananda, for day four.
Thank you. Okay, well, hi to everybody. Yeah, for those that haven't joined us before, you can catch up with the recorded stuff, of course, but really, I'm going to start by leading us through what we've done so far, as a single integrated practice, and then we'll go on to the particular area that we're looking at today, which, in the terms that Sangrajna used, it's spiritual death. More generally, it's referred to as insight or wisdom practice. So we're going to just do some somatic explorations of that area, and I'll go into that after we just do an initial meditation. So let's just set up and sort of, a quick resume. It will be quite quick, relatively, of where we've been so far. So just find your usual meditation posture. And as soon as you're settled, just sit to be open to what's here, whatever that may be, what's arising in the mind, what's arising in the body, and in the other senses. Now, whatever mental activity there is going on, there might be a lot, there might be a little, it might be quite insistent or reasonably quiet. So we're not going to address the mental activity directly, but indirectly, by simply shifting our awareness from mental activities into the tactile feelings of the face and the rest of the head. So experiencing the head somatically as sensei energy rather than the location of the conceptualizing mind. And just let your awareness explore different areas of sensation around the face, around the jaw, around the scalp, and so on. And then let your awareness start to come downwards in the body, down through the neck, through the throat. And as you bring it down, as you let it come down, or bring the awareness down, just be right there in the sensations that you're experiencing at that moment. So let go of a sense of still being up in the head in some way. Coming down through the chest, through the diaphragm, the solar plexus, into the abdomen. Down into the lower abdomen. And the sensations of contact with the seat and the floor. Let your awareness remain there when it gets there. Just resting in those sensations. And be aware of those sensations as alive, as energetic or vibrational, rather than as a kind of solid lump. So this is the grounding of our posture, and we're literally grounded on the ground, on the earth. And we're always in relation to the earth via gravity. So our body is always in relation to the very center of the earth through gravity. So sense the earth as a vast, spacious, energetic entity rather than rock and lava and so on. Sense yourself as part of the earth. And then if you've been finding the method useful, you can use the in-breath to breathe up from the earth. So first of all, on an out-breath, breathe down through the pelvic floor using your imagination, but also a sense of opening to the possibility that this is real, that we can actually extend our awareness and our breath below. So on the out-breath, into the earth. On the in-breath, it comes up, again through the pelvic floor, right up the core of the body, towards the spine, up through the neck, through the head, even above the head. So doing that a few times to bring some energetic lift and alignment into the posture, better alignment. And of course, with all these things I'm suggesting, they are suggestions. So if you haven't been finding something useful, do what you do find useful. So notice the effect or lack of effect. Check your alignment further by making sure that the chin is neither jutting out nor pulled excessively in. There should be just a very slight stretch to the back of the neck. And check also for the balance of the upper body. So just moving very, very subtly back and forth, left, right, to find the point at which it really feels centered and poised. And then just let go of any holdings, contractions, tensions. At least those that are susceptible to being let go. And you could have a sense of them sinking down and out into the earth. And then just sitting as the whole breathing body. The whole cloud of sensations, as I've been calling them, of the body. If you find your awareness constantly pulled into thinking, into proliferation, then just detach or unhook from it again and bring your awareness down to the hara, which is the lower abdomen. So in between, more or less halfway in between the pelvic floor and the navel, and somewhat more towards the back of the abdomen, but kind of in the center. Just let your awareness come into that area and breathe into the hara, with a sense of the breath going in there. There are some probably subtle breathing related sensations in the lower abdomen. You can follow the rhythm of the breath. Potentially you could go into the mindfulness of breathing and even use counting if you wanted to. But I suggest staying with the hara if you can, for the time being. So as the awareness becomes embodied, the mind quite naturally settles, almost, you could say, of its own accord. We don't have to do anything directly. Now, from the hara, if that's where you've got your awareness right now, bring the awareness to the heart, to the heart center. And as we were doing yesterday, if you're not quite sure where it is, you can just ask the body, ask your soma, where is the heart center? You may even find it's not where you thought it was. So just let your awareness rest in the heart center. Be aware of its quality or qualities. Let go of any notion of what it should be like and just be open to how it is right now. It might not be full of love. It might be quite contracted and painful. Or it could just be very spacious. So how is it? And just also let there be some awareness of the area behind and possibly slightly below the heart center where you're experiencing it, which has its own particular quality. And let that be part of the overall sense of the heart. You might find it imbues the heart center with a slightly different quality. Now, staying primarily with awareness in the heart, but aware of everything else in your experience right now. Just open to a quality of kindness, goodwill, benevolence, well-wishing. Just be open to the possibility that that quality, use the different words for metta, that quality is already here. We only have to open up to it, or the heart only has to open up to it. Just let that sense of kindness and so forth pervade your whole being. And then just let go of any limitations to it. Let it be unbounded. Let it be all-inclusive, including everybody and everything. If particular people or beings come to mind, that's fine. But generally, there's just a sense of the boundlessness of this goodwill, this kindness. Now, without detaching from that, just let it sort of remain. But let the awareness more be of the whole body, the whole somatic sphere again, the whole cloud of sensations, with this sense of kindness pervading it all. And just use the metaphor of the cloud to get a sense of the body, the somatic body being spacious, having a dimension, but also having no clear edges or boundaries. See if you can actually discern that in your experience. It's like the sensations are appearing in this somatic space, but the space itself has no boundaries. And you could also include whatever sounds are happening in your environment in the same kind of space. You've got a sense of sounds just pervading the same space as the soma, as the body sensations. So just be aware as to whether this sense of spaciousness and lack of bounds is emerging in your experience. Okay, so I'll just say a little bit. I'm afraid I'll have to draw you back, not from that space. You know, see if you could still, even with your eyes open, keep a sense of the body being spacious. And we're going to be working with that in terms of the spiritual death or insight explorations that we're about to do. So I'm just going to give a very brief description here. There's an awful lot that could be said. But fundamentally, when Sangharakshita first introduced this as a system of meditation, he spoke of the area of the cultivation of insight as being spiritual death. And the way in which I understand that is that with spiritual death, what is dying potentially is certain illusions that we have about ourselves and the way things are. Yeah. So one of the primary ways in which the Buddhist tradition leads to those kind of insights is through the various emptiness teachings. And you're probably familiar, you certainly are, experientially so, with the three marks. So we've got impermanence, unsatisfactoriness, and insubstantiality. Yeah. So these are three, you know, they're not usually spoken of in this way, but they are three aspects or three applications of emptiness, because he's pointing to the fact that our experience is empty of permanence, you know, is empty of changelessness. Is empty of substance. It's empty of any kind of unchanging substance, any ultimately real substance. And it's also empty of satisfactoriness in the sense of the kind of ongoing, complete satisfactoriness that we'd really like to have. Yeah, we get a certain amount of satisfactoriness, but you know, we can't always depend on that happening. And you know, that is one of the main underlying causes of suffering, you know, which is what the Dharma is addressing. So if we see into any of those illusions, if we see through our holding to an illusion, you could say that either momentarily or potentially permanently, that illusion drops away. And that dropping away of an illusion is a spiritual death. Okay, so this is what we're going to look at the body in these terms. So one of the major ways in which we maintain a sense of substantiality and separateness is, well, I'm in here, I'm in the body, and everything else is out there. Yeah, so is this actually the case? You know, we very much feel that we are, you know, that somehow I am in the body. But I mean, really what we're looking for is, well, where is this I, where is this sort of substantial self, which is in here somewhere? So we're just going to do another somatic meditation, just building on the one that we've just done. And we're going to look, first of all, for whether we can find a separation of inside and outside. And I don't know how you found it with the, when I mentioned bringing in sounds just before the end of the last meditation, but that can also help give a sense of non-separateness, but we'll go into that shortly. Are there any observations or questions before we move on and actually do practice or two on that. If you do have an observation, don't forget to unmute yourself.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi. Yeah, I just wanted to say I did notice when I do bring sounds in, it definitely does give me a sense of being without edges, like connection at one, just not any outline around me or something. I can't quite describe. Yeah, just breaking down of that edge of my body.
I'm also... Is that more straightforward
when
than
I bring
the body?
Sounds in. Pardon?
Yeah, yeah. Is that more straightforward than getting that sense through the body itself? In other words, is it easier with sounds?
Yes, yeah. It seems to be more noticeable, I think. It's something that's there already, but I think, but that just makes it more noticeable.
Good, good, okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Tejananda.
Hello.
Hey, I found some success with that technique, but also some fear. Maybe some fear of unboundedness, and I thought it was kind of interesting. I think the meta is helpful in that regard, but I don't know, is that something that you've heard about before? Yeah, that kind of.
Oh yes. Yeah. No, I'm glad. Well, I'm not glad that you had fear, but I'm glad you brought it up. Because when we're beginning to open to our being in this different way, it can be quite challenging to the mind. And you know, the mind has its various insecurities. What we want above all is to be secure. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So feeling that we don't have any boundaries can be quite challenging. So I would suggest that if fear arises, as long as it's kind of not, you know, complete terror, then you just allow that it's there and continue anyway. But if you know, if you find you've had enough, then you just come back to a sense of the soma, of the body and metta, and you know, just remain with that. You can even get you can get a more sort of solid sense of the body again. And then you'd gradually open up into this spaciousness, which is available. Yeah. And eventually the spaciousness becomes neither challenging. In fact, it becomes quite delightful. And, you know, in a way, who wouldn't want to be spacious rather than all confined and closed in? Right. But the funny thing is, we don't always want to be spacious.
Right. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, well, let's just do another practice and begin to explore this in a more kind of insight way. So just this time, I'm not going to go through the posture and everything, but just bring awareness into the body, into the soma, into the sensate body, that whole mass or cloud of sensations, including the breathing sensations. And let the heart be in your awareness. Open to kindness, goodwill, love. And again, getting a sense of the whole somatic cloud as spacious or having dimension, but not having clear edges or boundaries. If you haven't quite got that yet, just explore your agile experience. Look to see whether you can find definite edges to the somatic body. Of course, mentally we can think of an image of the visual body as having apparently quite clear edges. But let go of that kind of image if you have it, and just come into the soma itself. So a way in which you could look at this is in terms of your experience of the somatic body now, can you find a definitive inside separate from a kind of definitive outside of the body? So yes, there are these sensations which we take as being inside the body, but there aren't any definite edges, and there is this sense of the space in which all of these are happening. And all of that is within awareness. Okay, now we'll do the same this time. Bring awareness to the sounds, the environmental sounds. Maybe sounds coming from your own body. So again, in terms of mental labeling, we can easily identify, you know, such and such a sound is my stomach grumbling or bones clicking or whatever, swallowing. And we label that as inside And maybe if we can hear birds or traffic or other sounds, they are labeled as outside. But are they arising in two kind of separate spaces, or are they all just arising in the same undivided space? Really letting go of any labeling and just experiencing the sounds as they are. Is there really an inside and an outside in the sphere of hearing? Okay, and then just let go and just sit for a few moments. We'll just check in about this. Okay, so would anyone like to describe what you found in terms of the soma and the sound, as regards inside and outside?
I found that there's, for me, and I know that this is probably not a good answer, but for me, there's like the difference between sound from inside and sound from outside is that sound from inside can mostly be controlled, and sound from outside, there's no control.
Oh gosh,
my battery's about to go.
what do you mean by it can be controlled?
Well, whatever sound is coming from inside, there's some aspect of voluntary control over it. You can change its speed, you can make it quieter, you can make it louder, you can change the timing, the rhythm, even sort of whatever bodily processes, there's some element of control to those. But stuff from outside is completely involuntary. There's no control.
Okay, so I mean, in a way, that is a bit of a side issue, because we're just concerned with the sounds and the feelings as they are. I would regard, well, for instance, if my stomach starts gurgling, I have no control over that. If I can hear my heart, I have no control over that. I mean, obviously, I could get up and go for a run and that would make it go faster. But primarily, my experience is that I don't have control over inner sounds any more than outer ones. If you start making certain noises, it's like you're manufacturing those noises. So you can do that, but it's like if you leave aside that consideration, there still is, are they inside or outside, even if you can control them?
Well, to me, it's quite crucial, because for a while I've had an extreme sensitivity to sounds. So actually, there has built up a whole load of actual felt somatic experience between sounds from outside and sounds from inside, kind of for that reason. And it's something I'm trying to unpick and undo.
Well, it's a question of looking for are there boundaries? What kind of boundaries are they, if there are boundaries? And just really going into it in quite a lot of detail, bringing your awareness into it. Mm. Anyway, I'll just see if there's anybody else who has any comments.
Yes, I have an interesting experience. I have tinnitus, all the time.
Mm.
And I don't notice it really a lot. I don't notice it. But now, because I had to notice sounds, it became very prevalent.
Yeah.
And although I was very much inside the experience of this fluidity between this fluidity, you know, this not, there's no boundary. The tinnitus was louder somehow.
Yeah, yeah. Could that just be that you became aware of it and bang, there it was? I mean, because I'm the same, I've got tinnitus. And it's usually, I mean, 99% of the time I don't notice it. But if I sit down and open the sounds, wow, there it is, you know.
Yes.
It also raises the interesting question of, is it actually there if you're not aware of it?
Yes. Indeed. Anyway, I have asked myself that question, yes. Yes. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else?
Yeah, Tejananda. Conflict.
Christine?
Yeah? Sorry for whoever I interrupted her. I found that really potent, actually, when you introduced this idea of sound of inside versus outside. For me, it's suddenly something really clicked of just like where is my somatic experience, and kind of realizing there is traffic where I am. There's also inside things. There's also bodily things. And that felt like a real kind of moment of mini insight of just realizing that the locus of experience is this human form for me. But I feel like there's a strong juxtaposition between that and the boundlessness, that kind of cloud quality, but it's all rested within the confines of this body. That's for me, it's really.
Yeah, okay, I mean, that's good, but you could notice, for instance, I sometimes get this, especially if I'm in somewhere a bit noisier than where I am now, that if there's traffic, it's like the traffic is going right through me. You know, the traffic sound is going right through me. There's no boundary between me and the traffic sound. So yes, here we are. We are embodied beings. At the same time, what we're exploring here is the nature of that embodiment as not necessarily being what we generally assume it to be. So that's where we're going with this. So, I mean, this is a very, very brief exploration of these things. It is something which you could well profitably explore for quite a long time. Oh, got my alarm going off. Excuse me, I'm gonna have to go and turn that off. Sorry about that. Anyone else got a comment?
Yeah, this the whole area of this, the idea of there being this cloud or a kind of empty space that where I was is new to me, and I'm definitely it's new, and it's something that you helped me to discover. And my body, aches and pains, my more or less permanent pain in my back and all those kind of pains, like straps of pain down my back and shoulder, agony, but discomfort. They're just like straps of paint in the air. And so this, when I started listening to the sounds that were my breathing and just what I could hear in the environment, that was just sort of going through this more or less a transparent space that was very difficult to define where I was in there. So whatever you did there in leading that has opened up a new dimension for me, literally. Thank you.
Good. Yeah, well, that is definitely kind of the direction I'm trying to point people in. So yeah, just if you feel inclined, continue to explore that.
Thank you.
I hi. Just wanted to say hi, Tejananda. I'm meditating outside, as you can probably see, and there was something when we were exploring the sound, when there was a bird song here, and I think a bird song your end. And because I was maybe not foregrounding thinking, but I was aware that obviously the sounds were coming from different places. So the space in which the sound was happening suddenly just got flung so wide open, you know, because I think it was a bit not conceptual. Or it's, you know, it's like, where is all that sound happening? And it just kind of, yeah, it was really, spacious and very undefined. Yes, cloud would be a good example for that in that case. It kind of felt almost like scattered would be the word I would use somehow, that sense of sort of starbursts out into this large space. So yeah, it was an interesting experience.
Yeah, that is interesting. Yeah, well, do you know, do continue to pursue that way of looking, and you know, also bringing in what we've just only got, what, 6-7 minutes left, but I just want to come back into this and bring in one more element to this exploration. But before that, does anyone else have a comment that you'd like to make?
Yeah, I think I got a real sense of the sense of no boundaries, that that the experience was quite alive without edges, but it had kind of like almost like focus points that kind of tapered out towards the edges.
Yeah,
and it was very dependent on my awareness. And at one point, I thought, "Oh, it's all awareness. That's kind of what it is." And how far could that extend, or something? Was the question like, is there any boundary to that?
Yeah. 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 Well, I mean, that is a very good question too. You know, so where is all this happening? Is any experience happening outside of awareness? It would seem obvious in a way that it can't be. So it's just like, well, whatever you're experiencing, even if it's say an aeroplane, or you know, if you're looking at the sky at night, distant, you know, stars many, many light years away, it's all in awareness. So you know, again, it gives you a sense of, well, are there actually edges? You know, we kind of mentally impute these edges, you know, to a large extent. Of course, it's also very necessary to, you know, have boundaries in certain circumstances, but here in insight practice, we're opening up to, you know, an unbounded sense of what we are, rather than a bounded sense. So yeah, good stuff. Okay, look, we've only got 5 minutes, and I just want to take this one little stage further, or just drop in one more aspect to this. So just come back into the meditation posture, or just close your eyes. And just let the awareness fill the whole somatic sphere, taking in the whole of your tactile sensate body, just as it is. So if you've got a sense of it being bounded, just explore that. If you've got a sense of questionable bounds, explore that. If you haven't got any sense of bounds at all, explore that with awareness. And then at the same time, be aware of the kind of intersecting sphere of sounds. And again, look, if you find bounds, explore them. If you don't find bounds, let awareness explore that. So obviously we could do this with other sense fields, but some of them take a bit more time than we've got. So we'll just go with the soma, the tactile body, and the sounds. So just let those two spheres be together in your awareness. Maybe you don't experience them as two separate spheres, but arising in the same space, so to speak. And the next question is, where am I in all this? Where's the thing, object, whatever it may be, that I call me in all this? So look with awareness for where I am or where I seem to be. If you start thinking about it, all you'll get is thinking. So it needs to be explored directly with awareness. Where am I in this sphere of body and sound that may or may not seem to have divisions or edges? Okay, so maybe that was only a little glimpse, but I'm afraid time is up for this session. So maybe, you know, if you have any thoughts or comments about that or observations, we will be able to come back to this tomorrow, because we're continuing with the area of insight in terms of spiritual rebirth. You know, that might be something that you can just sort of inquire into in the meantime. You just get into the sense of the space of the body and the sense of sounds. And then, where am I? Where am I in this space, so to speak? And see what you see.
Tejananda, any tips on how to let go of those conceptual frameworks, those inside and outside, those kind of, those structures which are obviously conceptual, but yet are the practical means by which we conduct ourselves through the world? Yeah, they can feel a bit tenacious. And sometimes when I start to let go of them, I hold on to them even more. So any thoughts?
Well, yeah, I think, it is a gradual process. So it's not necessarily that it's all going to drop away all at once. The more that you have glimpses, the more you can actually, in a sense, you're building up a sense of confidence or shraddha about it. Yeah. And it's worth just reflecting, you know, when you have one of those glimpses, just sort of spend a little time reflecting, okay, I saw that, that was genuine. And in that way, it becomes more kind of settled. Yeah, so I mean, that's one way in which you can address it. But I think also it's just a question of not believing your thoughts, really resolutely not believing what your thoughts are saying. And you're finding that openness to what is actually here as distinct from what you think is here. Yeah, so I mean, that's a couple of suggestions.
Thank you.
Okay, Bob, did you want to say something?
Yeah, if no one else wants to ask anything, I think, I mean, basically you've given me loads to think about because I, as you may see from my setup, I teach music, and actually part of the way that I teach, I'm always trying to encourage people to not control what you're trying to do, that the sound is in a way beyond your control. And it's funny because I have this extreme reactivity and sensitivity to noise that I realize now in this session comes from sort of control, I guess, that inside me I can control, outside I can't. I'm going to have to really, I think, reflect on this. And I'm not even sure that there's a question in there, but it did make me think about, you know, inside there is some level of control, outside there isn't, but you want to go beyond that. You want to kind of ignore that, you're saying, to see beyond control and non-control.
Well, I mean, ultimately, if you go into that final question that I dropped in about, you know, where am I in all this, it's like, well, there isn't a me who's controlling anything. Yeah, and you know, that's what we're looking for. We're exploring the Buddha's teaching of not self in that respect. So, you know, although relatively speaking, I can clap my hands and say, well, I controlled that. I made that happen. But I'm not controlling, you know, the actual sound. You know, I can make my hands come together, but I don't control the sound that arises.
It just you can't choose where your awareness goes. So, a central part of you, choosing where awareness is.
Well, the question which could take us another hour. I've got another Zoom to go to shortly.
Yeah,
yeah.
I'm going to have to come to one of your retreats and ask you these questions.
Yeah, you're very welcome to do so.
Thank you so much. I mean, I'm really deeply, deeply enjoying these meditations. They're I'm feeling them very deeply. Thank you so much.
Pleasure. Yeah.
Tejananda.
Hello.
Carbon battery. Hello.
Oh, yeah.
Could I just have a very quick question with about sounds? You know that the ear is sort of designed to give you a sense of direction of where something, a sound is coming from. When there's an awareness of that, is that in the sort of area that Lala Tavira was talking about? So that, is that a conceptual thing? The directional.
In a way it is. I mean, because actually, ultimately, we are constructing all of our experience. Yeah, and you could say if you're going to kind of use a sort of a modern neurological model that is all happening in the brain, but we're not trying to get to that kind of place, of just saying, well, it's in the brain, because that's just another conceptual understanding. What we're doing is just looking at our actual experience, never mind whether there's a brain or not in relation to it. And I mean, gradually we can penetrate the ways in which we are actually constructing our experience, but it's an incremental thing. So you have to go into these sort of delusions that you have about the nature of your experience one by one, and you see through one level, and then that opens out something which looks like the real thing, but then you begin to find that that's a bit suspect as well. So you're going more and more deeply into this. And generally speaking, the further you get, the more challenging it can become. So it's like you do have to be incremental, and don't forget, the somatic embodiment and the metta, because, they are really the basis for going into this stuff.